valence bond theory. When one s and one p orbital are hybridized, a set of two sp orbitals oriented 180 degrees apart results. Two p orbitals are left over, and they could be used for making pi bonds. Let's look at some examples. First of all, here's the 1s and the 1p hybridizing to give just two new sp orbitals. They give a linear arrangement when they're placed on the central atom. There's several examples of sp hybridization. Let's just take a look at the example for nitrogen, because in nitrogen, we have, according to the Lewis structure, a triple bond and then a non-bonding or unshared or lone pair of electrons on the nitrogen atom. We'll just look at one nitrogen atom to focus on it first, but they're identical and the overlap is predicted to be identical. So if we look at the electron configuration on the pure, isolated nitrogen atom, the ground state electron configuration, there's five valence electrons, and we expect the electron configuration to look like this. We know, because it's a small linear molecule, that we must have sp hybridization. So we're going to have a mixing of one of the s and the 1p, and then we're left with two 2p orbitals as they are. Now, based on the Lewis structure here, and the I know that in the sp that I have a region of electrons as far apart in space as possible from the other region of electrons, and further that one of them is a non-bonding pair and one must be available for bonding. So three of the electrons would be predicted to a pair in the sp orbital, a single electron in the other sp orbital, and then two single electrons in the available 2p electrons. So given all of that, then what we expect to see in nitrogen then is an sp orbital here and an sp orbital here. This one can contain a non-bonding pair of electrons. The same thing would be on the other nitrogen, an sp. And so this overlap here, between the electron in this sp and the electron in this sp would form a sigma bond. Okay, so an sp orbital on one nitrogen is going to overlap head-on with an sp orbital on the other nitrogen to form a sigma bond. Then we still have on this nitrogen atom a p orbital, which looks like this. Actually, a p orbital, I'm going to make it red so it's easier to see. That, let's say it's in the z-axis, and then there'd be a p orbital over here, each containing one electron, and so we would have some side-on overlap here. That would form a pi bond. That would be the second of the three bonds. And then, if this head-on overlap is in what we call the, let's just call that the y-axis, and then these p bonds here, we're in the z-axis, then I can have down this way, let's call this the x-axis, going along through here and here, here's an x-axis and here's an x-axis. I could have another set of p orbitals, the p orbital along that axis and the p orbital along this axis, each one containing one electron. So I could have some side overlap there between those p orbitals to give me another pi bond, okay? So the three bonds in nitrogen could be explained this way. The geometry, if you will, it's linear, it's just a little diatomic molecule, but is composed of one, and we'll go back to the blue, one sigma bond due to the overlap of the sp orbitals along the axes here, then one pi bond between the electrons in this side p that both existing in their own z-axis around the center point there of the nucleus, the z. And then finally, in the x-axis, if you will, along through here, the other p orbital with the electrons would have the side-on overlap right there. So that's how we end up with our triple bond explanation using both the Vesper theory and the valence bond theory, SP hybridization.